नमस्ते, साइको एनालिसिस एंड फिलोसॉफी। आई एम नॉट गुड इनफ। कॉन्ट्ररी टू द पॉपुलर बिलीफ, फार मोर पीपल बिलीव दैट दे आर नॉट गुड इनफ, दो दिस इज डिस्पाइट हैविंग प्रूवन अदरवाइज इन रियलिटी। द फीलिंग दैट आई एम नॉट गुड इनफ ऑफन कम्स अप इन साइकोथेरेपी ऑल्सो। सो लेट अस डिस्कस दिस क्यूरियस टॉपिक ऑफ आई एम नॉट गुड इनफ with our psychoanalysis consultant, Mr. Himanshu. Namaste, Mr. Vaidya.
Namaste.
Mr. Vaidya, can we start with the question that is it really true that a large number of people deep inside feel or have this feeling that I am not good enough?
Curiously, yes. Okay. Far more people than we believe or than we would like to believe actually feel that they are not good enough. And this feeling that I am not good enough, this belief is very pervasive in our society and in our race in general. Rationally speaking, state of affairs should be like this. People who are serial failures, who have failed again and again in life, they should be the people who should have this feeling, I am not good enough. And rationally speaking, those who have succeeded in life or those who are not serial failures and have hope of success in life should not have this feeling of I am not good enough. Strangely, people who have never failed or not failed enough number of times, not only them, but even people who have succeeded in life, even they have this feeling that I am not good enough. So much so that in psychology, there is a phrase which is called imposter syndrome. This syndrome means that people who have become directors, director generals, CEOs, heads of institutions, ministers, top bureaucrats, top scientists, even prize winners, top celebrities, even they have in deep within themselves a feeling that I am not good enough, and that this success that I have often is thought of to be unreal, and that maybe I am an imposter or somebody is impersonating me as a successful person, but I don't deserve this. So there is this whole range of I am not good enough, or just the belief that I am not good enough, to this imposter syndrome, where one believes that I am definitely not good enough. How come I can be so successful? I don't deserve this success. Something very wrong has happened, or I have done something wrong, or somebody is impersonating me, or maybe I am not myself. All these feelings occur because of I am not good enough. So from a simple I am not good enough to the imposter syndrome, this whole continuum is a continuum of I am not good enough, and there are many other aspects to this also. Strangely, even when we talk to them in therapy or as friends, we realize that success in the real world, no matter how big it is, has just not influenced the belief that I am not good enough. And the two things, the fact of life that one is good enough and the belief that one is not good enough, both of them coexist in the same mind in different compartments, and no amount of success is able to shake this belief that I am not good enough. And this is what makes this belief not only strange, but curiously interesting from a psychoanalytic and therapy point of view. Supriya, you are muted.
Can we think about what could be the reasons for this? I mean, why is such a feeling would exist in large number of people?
Yeah, it's something very interesting actually. That why such a feeling, such a false belief, unsubstantiated, unproven, unjustified belief should be in such a large number of people. Obviously, it cannot be reality. if it was reality and rationality, then we should have three different sets of people. One, those who are serial failures and believe I am not good enough, where the belief is congruent with their real life experience. Two, people who are successful and who believe I am good enough, belief congruent with their real life experience. And in between, people who are hopeful and positive, who have not yet proven themselves but believe I am good enough, or if I am not good enough, then definitely I am not bad enough. So they may have a kind of a normal central level of confidence and positivity about themselves, but no way they can have this feeling I am not good enough, because they have not yet been serial failures. So this would be a rational state of affairs. However, the human mind is not a reason machine, it's not a rational machine. And therefore, this is not the real state of affairs. The reality that we find is something quite different, that a large section of population believes somewhere in their mind very strongly, I am not good enough. So the question arises, what can be the causes of this belief, which definitely is not a rational, real belief? So let us look at those causes. The first cause, psychoanalysis tells us, is that the human species is a very dependent species. As a child, we are completely dependent, powerless, and helpless, and we are very weak or without any strength compared to the resourcefulness and the strength of our parents. So we are completely dependent upon them, and this creates a feeling of dependence, inferiority, powerlessness, and helplessness. And these four are the ingredients which are fertilizers for the plant of I am not good enough. This primary natural feelings of dependence, helplessness, powerlessness, and knowing that one is very small in size and very low in strength compared to the parents, this is the first feeling where one believes that I am not good enough, I cannot survive on my own, but the parents are good enough. Not only can they survive on their own, I survive because of them. So this is the first point where the feelings of inferiority, powerlessness, helplessness, dependence, resourcelessness, lack of strength, absolutely and relatively speaking, all these feelings are felt and one concludes, I am not good enough. Second element comes by the behavior of parents. If the parents are not physically and emotionally present enough, the child feels that it is so because he is not good enough. So the non-availability, physical and emotional, of parents also creates this thought in the mind of the child that maybe this state of affairs is because I am not good enough. Third is lack of admiration from the parents, what Kohut calls lack of mirroring. If the parents are not adequately attention and admiration giving, then again, this feeling of I am not good enough builds up. If the parents are very strict in toilet training or during the psychosexual phases of the individual first 5 years, again, when parents find fault, it concretizes the belief that something I am doing wrong, I am not good enough. Over a period of time, as the child grows up, and if the parents are highly critical, not admiring, not attention paying, again the child feels I am not good enough. At school, if the teachers are harshly critical and negative in their assessment, again the feeling builds up. Academically, one is not good. Sports-wise, one is not good. Or if the friends are very critical, again the feeling builds up, I am not good enough. If the attainments in schools and colleges is very low, again one feels I am not good enough. If the socioeconomic situations are such that a person does not have adequate resources, say for example in a college everyone comes in a two-wheeler or a car and somebody has to come on a cycle, again the inferiority starts biting, lack of assets and resources starts biting, and I am not good enough starts coming up. Some instances of public humiliation also can build in this thing very traumatically. Socioeconomic situations where somebody's caste, race, religion in a particular given social situation can bring home the person the feeling that one is not good enough, that one is a second class citizen. Everyday experiences with authority figures, police, government, the big other as Lacan calls it, that can also fortify I am not good enough. So there are variety of reasons to do with one's biology, one's family environment, one's socioeconomic situation, the politico-cultural situation, and the administrative situation, which can build up and fortify I am not good enough. And if one biologically has certain defects, then it becomes even more concrete I am not good enough. And particularly in terms of women, the whole idea of looks also makes many women conclude I am not good enough. So it seems this junction of I am not good enough is a junction which you can reach from a variety of places, from a variety of directions. And it is very likely that all of us or most of human beings would be facing some challenges or the other, which creates and fortifies this belief, I am not good enough. And one more important element is that in many cultures, it is a norm to be highly critical of others. And admiration is an aberration. Now, this is very true in India, where we find the levels of anxiety, negativity, and envy are so high that it's very difficult for any person to admire anyone else. And therefore, the critical parts start assaulting more and more, but admiration comes rarely. Now, this is not universally true. In some cultures, admiration is easy. But in most cultures, admiration is rare and criticism is every day. So all this put together, and one important point, I would say, if the parent is not good enough, then the child has to conclude that the parent is not good enough. However, if the child concludes this, then there is the possibility of child getting angry or doing something or rupturing the attachment with the parent, which is survival threatening. And therefore, the child takes it upon himself that the parent is good enough, but whatever wrong is happening between them, whatever non-pleasant activities the parent is doing by omission or commission, that is not because the parent is bad, but because I am bad. So the parent is bad is turned inwards and the child puts it on himself to keep the parental image as the good parent image, because that is the only way attachment can be preserved, which is necessary for survival. And therefore, for such children in their adult time to own up that I am good enough arouses a lot of anxiety because it is tied up with survival. They develop a strange situation that owning up I am good enough will create a threat of survival. Or in some cases, the moment the child assumes the position I am good enough, parents attack him. So the child concludes it is not safe to be good enough. So it is safer to to assume the position, a self-critical, self-beating position of I am not good. So these are all the reasons why most people, or if not most, let me say a substantial part of, substantial proportion of people have this belief, I am not good enough, which has nothing to do with reality, but mostly is a psychological phenomenon.
Can we discuss some clinical manifestations of this feeling or this phenomenon?
Generalized anxiety disorder, avoidant personality disorder, paranoid personality disorder, performance anxiety problems, softer panic problems, problems of, these are like more like DSM problems. From a psychoanalytic point of view, difficulties of closeness, difficulties of feeling wholesome, difficulties of feeling good enough, catastrophic thinking, not being able to work, not being able to face any challenge, all the avoidance issues, avoidance of social situations, avoidance of work situations, avoidance of academic challenges, avoidance of any task where one fears that one's being good enough does not leave one capable of accomplishing the task, and moving away from all challenges. Moving away from all limelight, moving away from acquiring the center stage, taking a very submissive role, living on the corners of situations, not being on the center stage, and many other areas we can think about as manifestations of I am not good enough. The most common is anxiety, avoidance, and catastrophic thinking. But you will find that in most personality disorders, I am not good enough ultimately will come up in the course of therapy.
How can we heal ourselves of this problem?
It's a very deep problem because it also depends upon what intensity we are dealing with, mild, moderate, or severe. And most people who come to us come out of moderate and severe. Very few would come to for mild kind of problem. At least in India, they won't. So, there are three ways of healing it. One can work on it oneself. And in some cases, some people will succeed. You can work on it with a coach or a spiritual person or a development psychologist or something of that sort, that's second way. But when it becomes difficult, I think there is no option but to work with a therapist. Because this is a classical therapy problem. And in therapy, we have to work at all the three levels of thought, emotion, and behavior. And inculcate a lot of awareness to first make it very clear that it is a false belief, not grounded in reality. It is in contrast to reality. Although unreal, no matter how strong it is fundamentally unreal and irrational. And once this appreciation happens, at least at the cognitive level, the person knows I am good enough, although I cannot believe it with whole of myself. So the first is to create this, I am good enough. And there are two different broad manifestations of it. I forgot to mention it in the last question, I should have. I am not good enough manifests in two different ways, generically speaking. One is, straight away it manifests as I am not good enough, which is what you see in generalized anxiety disorder, performance disorder, social anxiety disorder, avoidant personality disorder, in some cases of even OCPD, in some cases of paranoid personality disorder, obsessive compulsive personality disorder. But in certain cases, I am not good enough manifests after the defense of reaction formation acts on it. Now that manifestation we see in narcissistic personality disorder and histrionic personality disorder. And we also can see that in some of the psychopaths and sociopaths, that a deep-seated I am not good enough. And in some cases, we can also see that in some cases of mania, where I am not good enough, on this particular element, the defense of reaction formation works, and one takes a completely opposite position, like a somersault, you jump over with a pole to the other side. So a person with I am not good enough, in some cases becomes a narcissist. I am all good enough. So in many cases of narcissism, when the narcissistic core gives way and we are able to go inside, we see that at the core is an inferiority. I am not good enough. And one jumps out of that inferiority into its opposite position of narcissism, of I am omnipotent, I am grandiose. Similarly, in histrionicity, I am not good enough takes the form of something seductive. I am extremely good enough, I am seductive. I am outlandish, I am extraordinarily good, I stand apart. I am not one among the masses, I am special. So it goes to the other extreme, right? One does not move from this I am not good enough to realistic position of who I am. One goes to the other extreme of I am all good enough. So in therapy also we see both these manifestations, not only in DSM terms. Of course, in DSM also we see both the manifestations, and in therapy when we try to heal, again both the manifestations come. I am not good enough coming up straight away as I am not good enough, and I am not good enough coming in terms of its opposite of omnipotence, grandiosity, extraordinariness, seduction, and all those manifestations. And therefore, in psychotherapy, we have to work based upon what we are dealing with. Where there is direct manifestation, we have to move from there to normalcy. And where there is indirect manifestation, through interpretation, we have to first know the opposite of what is manifesting and then move back to normalcy. And I think for this particular problem, this is one of those issues where psychoanalytic psychotherapy is a very good way of healing this I am not good enough. Because,
So, can we go a little bit more in detail about how do we engage with this issue in therapy? And as you already mentioned, psychotherapy is a good way.
Yeah, psychotherapy is a good way, and within that, psychoanalytic psychotherapy is a very suited way, congruent way for this particular set of problems. And we find I am not good enough manifesting directly and indirectly in therapy. And based upon how it is manifesting, we have to take the course of therapy. And usually, the effort is to move to the realistic normal zone, which is in the middle. One can start from the bottom or one can start from the top. The goal is to move towards the realistic space in the middle. And the routes are different. If we are starting with direct manifestation of I am not good enough, it would be a good idea to start with the supportive stance. At times, we may even have to give validation, approval, and a corrective experience. Whereas if one is starting from the opposite, where reaction formation has acted upon I am not good enough, and we see it's grandiose or how do we say it? Flaunting expressions. Grandiose or flaunting expressions of I am not good enough. It's opposite. In histrionicity or narcissism. Then we have to get into interpretative mode. And if the person is too weak for interpretation, then we have to get into the cohesion mode, in the cohesion mode is slightly different, because in normal courts we would either take the supportive mode when I am not good enough is directly manifested, then we would take the interpretative mode when it is manifested in terms of its opposite or its flaunting nature in narcissism or histrionicity. If, however, in indirect manifestation, in narcissism or histrionicity or something like that, the ego is too fragile, then the cohesion way of allowing the person to live out one's grandiosity can be a necessity before one can get into the interpretative mode. This is one aspect of therapy. The second aspect of therapy is we have to look at all the three parts. We have to work at the cognitive, affective, and behavioral level. And this is where we have to slightly move away from the classical frame, because this aspect, this problem requires all the three. It requires behavioral intervention, it requires intellectual and affective. So we start with cognitive part, we clear it up. We make the person realize that in reality he is good enough. He just has a belief that he is not good enough. It is not that he is not good enough. So first the cognitive war has to be won. Then the person has to feel at least cognitively I am good enough. This is where evidence points to. So evidence tells me I am good enough, although I believe I am not good enough. So then it is a question of fighting the false belief. Once the belief is known to be a false belief, it's much easier to handle than to just say it is my belief. So there is a world of difference between my belief and I know it is a false belief, but it is there. So this is the first journey we undertake, from this belief, from a conviction to my belief, and from my belief to I know it is a false belief, but a strong belief. So this is the cognitive aspect. The second aspect is, and this is the cognitive aspect is not difficult, because most people who come to us have some attainments in their lives, they just discount it. And in the imposter syndrome, it is at the extreme, as though a catastrophe will befall them if they accept they are good enough. It's almost as though they are committing an Oedipal crime or an unforgivable crime in front of the parents. Like they have to disown their success in order to feel safe. So this brings us to another important element, the whole element of safety, which we see in personality disorders. So when we come to the range of psychosis and personality disorders, the fragile spectrum, safety is very important thing. And one of the key areas there is to make the person feel safe, that even if I own up my goodness, even if I believe I am good enough, I will be safe. So safety is very, very important. Until the person feels safe, it is terrifying for the person to own up I am good enough. And these fears are so deep-seated that consciously one may not know it unless one really digs deep. So in the range, the fragile range of psychosis and personality disorders, safety is very, very important. That creating safety in therapy, making the person feel safe, and that calls for a very Cohusian approach, a very Rogerian approach, a very loving and kind and accepting approach. That is very essential for the person to feel safe and then own up, I am good enough. Otherwise, it's like an unforgivable crime in front of the attacking and assaulting parent, or almost in some cases an Oedipal crime to be successful. It's like killing the father. So whether it is Oedipal or whether it is to do with parental fear or whether it is to do with long-standing habit, one does not know what it will be like to be good enough. But not to be good enough is a known devil. It's a familiar territory, even though a torturous territory. So what I call a tragic holding state. A tragic state, but a familiar state. One knows one has survived, although suffered, but survived. And that is where one feels even the torturous stage is giving some sort of holding because it is allowing you to survive. And that creates this tragic holding space where one is stuck and one dares not come out of it and try something else. So anything healthy is seen as life-threatening. The movement to health itself is seen as life-threatening because ill health is a long-standing friend, although a treacherous friend.
Can we say that even ill health or a state of suffering also starts feeling safe because the person has survived in that state?
Yeah, when something, some suffering becomes enduring for long, one, you develop a familiarity and some sort of safety with it, at least of survival. And two, it can give you secondary gains. And three, you get habituated. So any alternative seems threatening. Is the fear of the new.
And so for a therapist to even create that alternative safe space from this state also must be a challenging task for the therapist.
Yes, because one of the elements is that this transition is very difficult. The man is stuck because of both positive and negative reasons. And the positive reasons have to do with secondary gains and a secret pleasure which often accompanies conscious suffering. So the conscious suffering often is accompanied by an unconscious pleasure. So one has to give up the unconscious pleasure and the familiarity and safety of that state and secondary gains. All the three have to be given up for the sake of health, and it is not easy to create compensating pleasure in the state of health to more than balance out what you are getting right now.
Right.
So it's not easy to create a new bargain to give up the old one.
And does it happen that in the between the reaction formation state and the person straight away accepting that I am not good enough, the earlier, I mean, the reactive state is more difficult to deal with? The reaction formation state when the person has become narcissistic or histrionic or something. And in the other state when the person is aware that I'm not good enough and kind of comes to admit.
I find
both are equally challenging.
Both are challenging, no doubt about it. Both are challenging.
Right.
These are not easy situations. These are all difficult long-term therapy situations.
Right.
Both are definitely challenging. But two remarks I would like to make here. One, I find it easier personally to deal with the reaction formation cases. Because one is dealing with strength there. So to come down from higher strength to lower strength is relatively easy, but to build up strength from scratch up is very difficult. Not that you don't get to the bottom. The moment you undo the reaction formation, the person falls to the same place where the person without reaction formation has fallen.
Right. So does it not become shattering for him or her?
Yes, but the structure of the personality is such that again, the personality works out to recreate that position of strength. And whenever he is in the position of strength, at least it's easier to do cognitive and some sort of behavioral work. Whereas in person who has accepted it and by and large anxiety is out of control. In case of narcissism and histrionicity where some sort of reaction formation has worked on inferiority, or some other defenses worked on inferiority, the sublimation or channelization of anxiety is much better. Anxiety does not just erupt directly in a primitive way as it does in cases where I am not good enough is not accompanied by defenses and is directly accepted. So those are more difficult cases where often we need homeopathy or psychiatry to calm down that anxiety so that we can work better with it. Unless the person really is capable of enduring and living with that anxiety. Because in most cases, the anxiety is just exploding through. And therefore, I feel the cases where reaction formation, some sort of defenses work, or I am not good enough, or the inferiority, are relatively easier than the other counterpart. And second remark I want to make is this. In a large number of cases, I'm not saying every case, but a large number of cases, early life object loss is often the root point of starting of I am not good enough. That the child concludes because of object loss that the object has abandoned him because he's not good enough. And it is fortified by the fact that despite his trying everything that he can, he cannot get the object back. He is powerless and helpless, incompetent, and therefore not good enough. So these two primary fortifications of this feeling, this belief, are very difficult to undo. And for this particular group of people where I am not good enough is rooted in early life object loss, I have this approach of the Valley Junction model. And in that Valley Junction model, we can see how all personality disorders can potentially emerge. I'm not saying all emerge, can potentially emerge. 75% of them, I believe, emerge in this way due to early life object loss. And this early life object loss creates this psychological state, which I call the valley state. The valley state of anxiety, pain, helplessness, powerlessness, inferiority, I am not good enough, at times even accompanied by guilt and shame. And people react in two ways to this state. Some people get out of this state accepting I am not good enough. Some people use defenses and come out of this state with narcissism or histrionism. But the root state is for a large number of people the same. So when we start exploring I am not good enough in a histrionic, in a narcissist, in an avoidant, in a paranoid, in generalized anxiety disorder, social anxiety disorder, performance anxiety, and a variety of situations, in many cases we ultimately result in the same thing, early life object loss. And there my model of Valley Junction model of personality disorders can be used with some customization as the need be. And that Valley Junction model can also be used to quicken up therapy. And this is very important because I have seen if we use that model in the context of psychoanalytic psychotherapy, it quickens up the whole thing. And one way to use it is to point out to the client how that model is in operation first without naming the model, and then giving the model to the client to read. And the client then sees the whole picture and comes back and feels much better because he now can make sense, coherent sense of the whole thing. He knows it's not only him, but many like him. And all of this reduces his anxiety, the anxiety of the unknown, and the anxiety of being the only sinner in the world or the only condemned one in the world and not knowing what is happening. And once you know this, the solution becomes very clear and one can slowly apply it. And it's very important to apply it when the inferiority, and I am not good enough is active, because this is not a algebraic operation where minus 3 plus plus 3 is 0. No amount of success in the outer world helps you overcome I am not good enough. So it has to be dealt in a different way. It is not that you tell yourself, a part of me believes I am not good enough, now let me succeed in something and then tell myself, look here, I have succeeded, so I am good enough. That does not take care of I am not good enough. Even after you succeed, it still continues to exert the same influence. So it is not a problem which can be solved by achievement. It is a problem that has to be psychoanalytically solved by observing it when it is active and putting into place, into operation, a transformative insight. And that happens only when a state of transformation exists in the psyche. And often we may have to create that state of transformation before the insight can take effect. So these are some of the aspects we have to deal with in psychoanalytic psychotherapy of I am not good enough. And this is an issue where all the three, behavior, affect and thought, have to be dealt with to really address the problem, and it has to be solved when it is most active.
So apparently not so, you know, threatening sounding this thing, I am not good enough, has very deep roots.
Yes.
One doesn't realize.
Yes.
I mean, many people mention this sometimes jokingly or something, but actually these things are very deep roots.
Very deep.
They are not that.
And we pay a very heavy cost for it. We just don't know. Unless somebody goes to the extent of becoming a diagnosed person, people don't realize the kind of cost that they are. And if we
look at, someone says or mentions this,
please go.
Yeah. So even someone says or mentions this in a casual kind of conversation, it should not be just laughed at or taken lightly or something, I believe. Definitely indicates something much deeper than what the person is saying.
Much deeper and much more important than the person realizes. I am not good enough. If you look at the cost of it, the cost is very heavy. And there is a very strong influence of this belief on our quality of life.
Okay, so talking about psychotherapy, we come to Kohut's approach. Is his approach quite different than others in the healing of this particular feeling?
Yes, it is quite different, because Kohut believes that we all have omnipotent exhibitionistic tendencies in early childhood. And if we don't get adequate opportunity to exhibit this exhibitionistic, or rather live out these exhibitionistic tendencies, these histrionic tendencies, these grandiose tendencies, then if we don't get a chance to live them out, or if we don't get admiration, we live out but we don't get admiration, then intense sense of shame and inferiority develops. So for Kohut, it is a developmental arrest. And therefore the developmental process has to be restarted by re-experiencing what he calls mirroring experiences, idealizing experiences, empathic experiences, self-object and witship experiences, and going on being experiences. He calls it lack of impingement. Minakot calls it going on being, but you can use going on being there. In therapy, therefore, the approach changes from one of interpretation to one of holding and allowing the person to live out what could not be lived out, and therefore it is a corrective experience, not necessarily by commission, it may be by omission, but it is essentially a corrective experience, and therefore much different and much at odds with the classical psychoanalytic approach. And some of the ways in which transference is interpreted, particularly in self-object and twinship terms, is very different in the Kohutian approach than in the classical psychoanalytic. So new concepts and new approaches come in the moment one gets into Kohut. And when we are looking at I am not good enough, in many of the cases, the Kohutian approach may be the right approach.
Come to our last question. Can holistic healing and spirituality help us in resolving this issue or dealing with this feeling?
Yes, because holistic healing tools like Reiki, pranic healing, some medical systems like homeopathy are very good in helping us to heal partly or fully this problem. So homeopathy, pranic, Reiki can be used as even some yogic techniques, visualization, psychodrama, they can be used as complementing techniques to psychotherapy. In some of the cases, homeopathy works so well that psychotherapy may not be needed after some time. And the problem is healed completely with homeopathy in some cases, not all cases, some cases. And where possible, I think it's very good because it's much cheaper and much quicker. Not quicker, I would say, but definitely cheaper. Because there also it takes nothing less than 2 to 3 years. And I think that's the same kind of time that therapy would take. 1 to 2 years would be a very natural time for therapy. And in some cases, even 3 years. But time-wise, there's not much difference. But cost, time, and cost and energy wise, there's a lot of difference. So these are some of the complementing things. Spirituality brings in a very different element because it brings in the element of the meaning of suffering. That somehow it is not only a stroke of misfortune and accident that you have this problem of I am not good enough, but that there is a meaning to this problem of I am not good enough. Because of three reasons. One is balancing the karmic debt. Second, so you are living out according to your karmic pattern and you are paying back for some wrong done in the past. Second is you may want to have a particular experience which may not be profitable or pleasant to your outer nature, but something in your inner nature wants that experience. So the self wants an experience, even though the persona does not want that experience. So it is the purpose of the self, which is independent of the karmic debt, which is the second reason why you have that experience. And the third reason is when you overcome such a problem, then you develop strength, the opposite of this problem, much higher than most others. So when you come out of inferiority, the confidence that you develop is much better in quality and much stronger than confidence of a normal person who never had this problem. So it is also a developmental opportunity. So spirituality brings in these elements apart, which are not classically the part of discourse of psychoanalysis or psychotherapy. Secondly, spirituality brings in a basket full of techniques of how to heal it, and it includes idol worship, visualization, technique of mantra, technique of some alchemical mystical processes, technique of yoga, technique of certain healing procedures, and the use of herbal medicines. All of this is something that spirituality brings into the table. And if we can, with an open mind and with a scientific spirit, combine all the tools that we have to create a customized basket of healing for a given individual, healing is swift, with lowest amount of pain and cost to the person, and contributes maximally to the development of the person apart from healing.
Okay, Himanshu ji. I think today we have extensively covered this very interesting topic, which was not really recognized as such. Yes. As it's such a deep issue.
Right.
So it's been really useful and enriching to engage with you in this discussion. Thank you so much. And if there is any query, do write to us at hvindia@gmail.com. Namaste.
Namaste.